science is going to truly lead our future, then we first need to look at our past and honor it. Learn from it. Build on its foundations. And use all of that as our guide to sustainability. Our world, a collection of heritage, history, people, places. And our future must include all.
Please welcome AGU's President-elect, Lisa Gromlich.
Since the beginning of time, the night sky has been a source of wonder and inspiration, illuminating stars that over millennia have guided towards home, towards safety, and even freedom. Distant planets sparkling from afar that continuously beckon new generations of explorers, or sometimes being the canvas for just a small, quiet moment of reflection. To paraphrase the phrase, it's the greatest show looking up from Earth. And if you take that, our next presenter is, I'd say, the MC of the night sky. So Babak Tafreshi is a photojournalist and a National Geographic explorer. He is a renowned cinematographer, a fearless activist, a tireless educator, who uses the context of night sky photography and visual storytelling to bridge art and science, culture and nature, conservation and exploration. Since the 1990s, Babak has been recording breathtaking scenes of the night sky and rare celestial phenomena on all the continents. His work reveals the wonders of our universe, providing the perfect platform for the issue of light pollution. And to harness this power, he created the World at Night program in 2007, and since then has been directing a team of over 40 people in over 20 countries that include some of the world's most accomplished night sky photographers. Babak is also a science journalist. He's a contributing photographer to Sky and Telescope magazine and the European Southern Observatory and the U.S. National Center for Ground-Based Astronomy. Babak was born in 1978 in Tehran. He left Iran in 2011. His passion for astronomy and astrophotography started when he was 13, and he took a first look at the moon through a telescope. Later, he became fascinated by the universality of the night sky. He studied physics, he shifted to journalism. He has received the 2009 Lennart Nilsson Award in Stockholm, the world's most recognized honor for scientific imaging. He was awarded the 2022 National Geographic Wayfinder Award for pushing the boundaries of science, exploration, education, and storytelling to transform our world. Babak's latest book, The World at Night, and his work has been featured in the documentaries Acquainted with the Night, Borderless Sky, and Equator, A New World View. Please welcome the incomparable Babak Tafreshi.
Everyone. Pleasure to be here. Thank you, AGU, and my good friends Josh and Nilufar, who invited me to the talk. For the past 25 years, I've been documenting night to sky in perhaps more than 1,000 nights under stars. I became almost a nocturnal species. So you go to work in daytime, I sleep after sunrise. But this type of dark natural night to sky, which still exists in some few locations here and there on the planet, are the last refuge that we have. Because in the past few decades, especially, light pollution or artificial light at night, or ALAN, has really exploded in the amount of immensity and the number of them around the world, especially in places which they didn't have electricity before. And the night sky has been vanished in most of the major cities. In many countries, more than 60% of humanity at the moment cannot for sure see the Milky Way, and about 95% or more in developed world cannot see the Milky Way anymore, for example, in the US. And inside the cities, we are also disconnected from these natural elements. We don't have time or attention to look at the moon simply. This is a view of moonset in Boston. I was a few miles away taking a long telephoto lens shot of the moon setting down. And I usually cut the video somewhere a few seconds later because there was some privacy in one of the rooms. So I don't like to show it in such a huge window, a huge screen. But it's not only about astronomers. It's not only stargazers that care about natural night environment. Beyond being just a laboratory to astronomers, which is true in much larger context, night sky is part of our environment. This was a peaceful lake in Maine. I recorded the sound of loons exactly at the same time of photography. It was 20 second exposure, 20 second of recording. My family was in this boathouse. They couldn't sleep the first night because of the sound. This eerie, beautiful sound of loons. But where are they now? They're no longer in many of these lakes simply because of light. If you switch on a few LEDs, they're gone to another habitat. Some of the most striking things that I have witnessed were, for example, active northern lights. I've documented them in both hemispheres, from Arctic to Antarctic. And sometimes they became so active that dominate the entire sky. This is a 360 panorama. In fact, I changed my entire presentation yesterday. I was working the whole day to fit the screen. As soon as I realized this is a wide panoramic screen, I created a new presentation and using 360 panoramas, which I have created in the past 10 to 15 years. This is in Guatemala. It's not a 360 panorama, but it's showing you fuego and very active supercell creating thunderstorms. Fuego and Pacaya are two most active volcanoes in Guatemala, and night under stars, it's really striking to look at them and to document them. They're also very long lasting. In the past several years, they have been constantly active. From Guatemala, now we are in Grand Canyon National Park on the border of Arizona and Utah. This is the beginning of night, the beginning of nightscape photography. It's not necessarily about astronomy. Nightscape photography is a bridge between several things. It could be geology, atmospheric science. For example, we are looking at one atmospheric phenomena here, which is visible twice every 24 hours, and most people never recognize it. It's called the Earth shadow. On the left, in this 300 degree panorama, is the sunset. Sun is already gone a few minutes ago. And on the right, the Earth shadow is coming up. That blue band opposite the direction of the sun is the Earth shadow. You need clear horizon opposite the sun and transparent the sky in order to see it. Every night, right after sunset, and every morning. And sometimes it comes with some rays forming, which is a crepuscular or anticrepuscular rays, which are visible over there. From Grand Canyon, now we are in California, in the Sierras. You're looking at the Minaret Peaks, about 12,000 feet. The new moon is setting. I captured this through a telephoto lens, and the red vivid dusk, because of the wildfires, it was during August, the wildfires in Yosemite created that. So these are all within nightscape photography in Moscow. And now we are looking at another moon site, this time in summer, in high latitudes of 50, 55 degrees. The moon, even near the phase of first quarter, sits very close to the horizon in the summertime. From Moscow to New England. We're near Boston, in the town of Waltham, above this historic monument. The full moon is rising exactly at the time of civil twilight, so some minutes after sunset. And this is at the peak of maypole colors in late October. Comets. Every decade or so, we have a bright comet. There are icy bodies. Most of you are very familiar with these terms and phenomena coming from the background of space and engineering, or sometimes even astronomy, I believe. Some of you are probably astronomers. Comets are not really large bodies in space. The core is only a few miles, like a mountain of ice. But when it scatters this dust cloud in space, it becomes huge, but very low density. When it reflects the sunlight, it becomes a notable object in the Earth sky. Most of them are telescopic objects. They're not visible to unaided eyes. Every few years or so, we have a naked eye comet that makes news. This was in 2020, comet NEOWISE. It's a project named after a robotic project that discovered these objects. And it's captured from White Mountains in New Hampshire at dusk. The next major comet, nobody knows when it's going to be a beautiful comet like Hale-Bopp in 97, maybe next year, maybe in 10 years. Still in twilight, we are in central Australia, in the heart of the country. This large single rock is sitting visible from hundreds, at least 200 to 300 kilometers away. It's visible when you're approaching this place. It's there on the horizon. And Uluru is a sacred site to Aboriginal people of Australia as well. In Arctic latitude, Iceland. This is the time of the night, we call it astronomical twilight. That's when the sun is about minus 18 to minus 12 degrees below the horizon. It's a very critical time for night sky photographers because you still have this beautiful deep blue color in the background of the sky, while sky is dark enough to show you the Milky Way, to be filled with the stars. So it's a perfect timing that doesn't last long unless you're in Arctic latitude where the angle of the sun motion is very shallow. Therefore, twilight lasts much longer. This is in southern Iceland near the famous town of Vík. This sea stack configuration has appeared in several science fiction movies. From Iceland to Nepal. Mount Everest is on the far left. Bright star Aldebaran is in the middle, Capella is on the left. What is the source of illumination in this panorama? It's all moonlight. Very often I use moonlight for source of light at nighttime because it's very uniform, it reflects the same color, so it's very natural looking. But what phase of the moon would be the best for night sky photographers? If you shoot on the full moon, sky is completely vanished. Only a few stars will be visible. If you shoot with the new moon, it's not much illumination to highlight the foreground. So it's usually near quarter moon, which means 50% disk illumination. And that was the case here. Or here, Mount Damavand in Iran. This is the country I come from, and this is a mountain I have spent hundreds of nights around it to stargaze. Because it's so close to Tehran, it's only 70 kilometers away from Tehran, and it's very important mountain in history and culture of Iranians. It's the highest live volcano in Asia, about 5,610 meters. And it's very symmetrical and massive at the same time, has been a symbol of freedom and resilience for Persian culture. And in the past 3 months, it's one of those symbols for the current woman life freedom uprising. Damavand is a natural uniting symbol for Persian communities usually. Source of illumination, again, is the moon, but not for the rock down there. That is lit by a road going by. Looks like a cut into the lava inside, well, the volcano, but it's illuminated by a road. From Iran, now we are in Colorado, near Aspen. You're looking at the Rockies Mountains in a section where the famous Maroon Bells are visible on the left side. In this 300-degree panorama, the moon is visible in the image. It's the quarter moon, and across the sky, stars are still there. The reason, the secret for shooting under bright moon with plenty of stars is high altitude. When you go to higher altitude, the sky becomes more transparent. There is less mass of air above you. Therefore, it's less scattering of light. And therefore, you will see more stars. Seems that all of a sudden it became daytime here. I would appreciate if we can switch off the lights again. Yes, I can see it's coming dim. Now we are in Chile, in the Andes. This ice formation, it's very common at altitude of 5,000 meters and higher in the Andes. And they're formed by wind and solar radiation. But the interesting thing in this picture is a common and familiar constellation, Orion, right in the middle. You can see Orion with that orange star, which is Betelgeuse, the shoulder of Orion. But there's something wrong for those of us used to viewing the stars in the Northern Hemisphere. Orion is upside down here, because those familiar constellations are visible in the Southern Hemisphere, but they are upside down. From Chile, let's travel to Yosemite in the fall, in November. The half moon or quarter moon, 50% phase, Orion is on the right side and El Capitan is on the left from kind of odd angle in the panorama here. From Yosemite, let's move on to this place, a dark place in Amboseli National Park of Kenya. This national park is right on the border of Tanzania, and two of the prominent objects in the southern sky are visible in the view. Many people love to do stargazing in the southern hemisphere. The main reason is the Milky Way core reaches overhead to the zenith. Therefore, the Milky Way is much more spectacular in the southern hemisphere and tropics compared to northern hemisphere, especially in high latitudes. We see the core of the galaxy very close to the horizon, but not here. Another thing is there are two galaxies visible to unaided eye beyond the Milky Way in the southern hemisphere. One of them is visible in this picture, the Large Magellanic Cloud. You're looking at the galaxy 160,000 light years away. And it takes you back in time to 160,000 years in the history of universe when you're looking at the light of that object. And also that nebula right off the branch of the tree, this is acacia tree, it's known as Carina Nebula. That's the largest nebula in the southern part of the sky. Speaking of the bright meteor, it was during one of the annual meteor showers known as Leonid. And two nights from now, let's see, no, actually tomorrow night, we are going to have a meteor shower, Geminid meteor shower. Good news is there is a meteor shower. Bad news is going to be overcast. So don't plan on it if you're going to be in Chicago. But if you're going elsewhere, look for it, especially on the morning of 15. After midnight, it's going to pick up a bit more, but it's visible from the beginning of the night. Other popular meteor shower of the year you can do stargaze or photograph is Perseid in August and also Leonid in November. There are about a dozen of them, but these are usually the three best we have. Death Valley National Park, an amazing diversity of geology here. But for a night sky photographer who wants to combine the beauty of earth and sky together, this view known as Artist Palette was really remarkable. How did I illuminate it? The moon was behind me. So the moon was rising no, sorry, the moon was setting in this case, and those two stars of the Gemini, the twins, the Castor and Pollux, were rising above the formation. A few minutes later, the moon was too bright. Before it was too bright, a few minutes later, the moon was gone. So timing is very important in these images when you care about the angle of the moon illumination on the foreground. Archaeology and astronomy has been always two of my hobbies, and astronomy became part of my job, but archaeology remained a hobby. And there is a reason that I like to combine the two, because when you look at the stars, you're looking at the history of the universe. These lights are coming from hundreds or thousands of light years before us. You're looking at the objects and remaining of our civilization. You're looking at the history of Earth and our own kind. Combining them together, it's very interesting bridge in art. And sometimes we have to document World Heritage Sites because it's important for the World at Night project to present landmarks which are familiar to the audience. This is a way to make night sky not only an abstract beauty in outer space for astronomers to explore, but a medium, a part of our environment that we can communicate with. So if these images come with a foreground which can resonate with each person, like a landmark, a nationally known landmark or a world heritage, it becomes much easier to communicate these images and communicate science of astronomy with people and preserve dark skies. That's why it's important to go to World Heritage Sites in our project. And it's challenging too, because many of them need a special permission. We even work with UNESCO in order to access to these sites, but the final decision is on the person who is there. So I have, you know, thousands of stories to tell you about how I couldn't get to a special site at night because of these struggles we have usually with World Heritage Sites. And it's very important for us to document them. There are more than 1,000 sites around the world at the moment. Now we are back in Iran. In central part of Iran, these salt domes have formed. They're very colorful, and illumination now comes from full moon. That's why there is nothing in the sky other than Venus, the second brightest object in the sky after moon in our nighttime. Venus is setting in this image, and the full moon is rising behind me. Sometimes the moon is absent, or in this picture, the moon is right on the horizon. So that's why only the top of the mountain is lit by the moon. The rest is receiving only starlight, although the image was much darker to me, but the camera using a 20-second exposure is revealing much more than human eyes. It's revealing colors which are not visible. We are in Grand Teton National Park in Wyoming. The light of Jackson is visible 20 miles away. That town is visible on the left. The Milky Way core galaxy with bright nebula known as Lagoon is on the left. Bright star Antares is orange because it's a super red giant. And on the right side, you have some green glow, which is not aurora, in fact, another atmospheric phenomenon known as air glow, which I will explain later on. But this is a very typical question I receive on social media or on my exhibits. Are these images real? Yes, because I do not blend different exposures. I do not blend daytime and nighttime images. Most of my photography are single exposure. Or single exposure panorama means several shots with the same setting stitched together to create a larger resolution and a better angle. So, but the question might be referring to, are these images the same as we can see with our own eyes? Then the answer is no. Although our eyes are quite sensitive, not as many nocturnal species, however, and our brain is stacking images when you're looking at the dim object, it's very interesting because if you look at the quantum efficiency of human eyes only, separated from the brain, we should not see the Milky Way. But we are seeing the Milky Way with a very low quantum efficiency, apparently, because it seems that the brain is stacking images to create a higher signal-to-noise ratio. Therefore, after you stare at the image for some seconds, you start to see more and more. While the physical entry of light is the same. It's just 6 or 7 millimeter aperture coming in, but stacking make the secret, make things visible, but not the color, because our cone cells are not active in low light. So the rods, which are more active at night and more sensitive, they're color blind. Therefore, we do not see color of any diffuse object at night or any low light environment. Milky Way is a great example. We do not see the color of the Milky Way. This was the view that I experienced with my own eyes. So there was no color, but Milky Way was perfectly visible. It was more diffuse, less contrast, but every single detail that I captured with that image was visible. I could see less background stars because the camera in a single 20-second exposure can reach magnitude of 8 or 9. Our eyes can reach magnitude of 6 in a scale of star brightness. But there was one single star that could activate the cone cells in my retina because it was concentrated enough and bright enough to activate that. That was Antares. We can see the color of the stars, the brighter ones, with our own eyes. You can see the color of Mars these nights. Mars is at the brightest time right now because it's in opposition with planet Earth. So it's quite bright and it's visible the entire night. Try it next time. The redness of Mars is visible very easily. It depends on the age too, to be honest with you, but usually anyone can see the color of the brightest stars if you look at it for some seconds. Then comes the question, what is the real color of these objects? When we do not see them, is there a real color? Yes, because there is a physical explanation for these colors. We see that super red giant star Antares orange and red because it has a lower surface temperature, about 3000 Kelvin, compared to a blue star like Rigel in Orion, which is more than 20,000 degrees, much hotter. Why Milky Way is yellow? Because of the dust between the stars in the interstellar medium. And we are looking through the galactic plane, there's so much dust that absorbs the starlight and makes everything more red. And therefore we have a yellow galactic plane. And we have some star clusters which are more blue. So every single of these has a reason. If I change this in my photography from, you know, 5,000 white balance to somewhere around 2,000, I can make everything blue. That's very common, unfortunately, on social media. It's okay for art. Photography is also art. But if you're doing this for documentary photography, realistic documentation of nature, this becomes fake. It's like changing the color of elephant to red. You know, you can do it for artistic reason, but not for documentary. Milky Way has its own color. Stars has a real color with physical explanation. That's why I'm sensitive to the colors of the object at night. I may enhance that color for educational purposes or presentation to show it better, but the color needs to be more or less accurate. And if I change this, for example, I did an example on social media about 12 years ago with these two pictures taken from Iran. This is the famous Alamut Castle, the legendary assassins in that area. And one was with a completely off tint, purple Milky Way. It received 10 more interaction on social media. So maybe that's the reason some photographers change the color of these objects so exotically. But the true color is what you can see with that pale yellow. Sometimes a natural phenomena can change the true color of the sky completely. Aurora can dominate the sky of high latitudes, such as Iceland, for example. Here is a famous waterfall illuminated by a light, and aurora is picking up during the night. It can grow to become something really immensely bright, casting shadows, creating colors that your eyes start to see them. Usually aurora, when it's faint, it's diffuse, you don't see any color. But when aurora hits scale number of KP 7, 8, 9, then your eyes can see very vivid colors. I could see blue on that night. The only time I could see blue aurora was on that night of March 2015. And that was the highest geomagnetic activity in several years. When the solar wind is coming to the Earth, it is, if it has a higher speed, say for example over 500 or dense, very high density, it's going to create a very beautiful aurora show. As you probably know, the solar maximum is coming in 2024 and 2025. So that means much more aurora activity in the next couple of years in high latitude, and they can reach down here too. Lake Michigan is a favorable place inside the US to see aurora more on the horizon, but they can come up as well, because we in this part of the Earth, in western side of the northern hemisphere, we are sitting right below the geomagnetic pole, the north geomagnetic pole. Therefore, from rather lower latitude, we can see aurora. From 40 degrees latitude here, it's possible to see aurora on the horizon if it's dark enough. While it is not possible to see aurora frequently from 40 degrees in China or in Central Asia, because it's away from the geomagnetic pole. So let's continue with the form of aurora which happens overhead. It's a perspective effect known as crown, and it's boiling in color and changing in rays and formation every second. It can last about 1 minute or so. And this is the most striking experience of viewing the northern lights. And in order to see that, you really have to be in high latitudes, because from this latitude, it's very, very uncommon to see a crown, unless activity is huge, which happened, for example, in 2003. Do you know what was the lowest latitude ever for observing northern lights or aurora? Equator, Singapore, in 1908, I think. Also, it was recorded from Mexico City about 80 years ago. So it can reach down there as a red halo on the northern horizon, but it's very rare. Aurora? No, this is air glow. It was very confusing to me at the beginning of my photography. I was doing long exposure on film in 94, 93, 95, in those years. And each time I was coming back from the laboratory with my slides, I could see some of these long exposure star trails are completely greenwashed. And I was blaming the laboratory the whole time that you're doing something, and they were telling me, do not use Fujifilm, they're more green oriented. And I couldn't find an answer until an astronomer told me this is air glow. And air glow is happening every night on this planet. Usually during the midnight it's more green, during the beginning and end of the night is more yellow and red. It's a pain for astronomers to remove it in deep images. But for night sky photographers using wide angle lenses, it's very interesting because it can create formations. The documentation of that can contribute to atmospheric science because they have waves which is related to atmospheric gravitational waves, not the physical one. And they are recently, you know, documented so well by photographers because they're rather faint. They're quite colorless to the eye. You feel them like a misty halo in the sky. You feel that the sky, there's something wrong. It's not that pitch black tonight. This is air glow. And they're not like aurora, which becomes vertical rays. They're more parallel to the horizon. They move very slowly. And this was the most intense air glow I have ever photographed in 25 years. It happened above Grand Teton in July 2013. And then I started to make this long panorama with the mountain. Let's have a look at some extreme example of air glow on the right side by two colleagues of mine. One is on film, one digital, from US and Chile. Especially Chile and Argentina are sitting under this South Atlantic anomaly, and they receive more of the air glow. And that's why they can capture some of these striking images of air glow activity. On the left side, you can see how air glow is visible in astronaut images from space station. They can always see it with eyes, it's colorless, but through their camera, you can see this green limb of the Earth atmosphere, this emission is coming from 90 kilometers above us. So it's almost on the edge of space. And it's mainly on infrared, the peak of the brightness, but it's also in the visible light, and it's always colorless to the eyes. Let's continue with some of the nights which doesn't have any of these. Completely dark, no moon, no twilight, and no air glow. Now we are in very dark environment of Mono Lake in California. I have illuminated that single Tufu Island in order to be highlighted in the image, but the rest is receiving starlight only. Mono Lake, now we are in Arches National Park. These are some of my favorite stargazing locations on the planet, where also they're designated as International Dark Sky Park. There are more than 200 of them. Arches is very close to a nearby town, but Moab does not create that much light pollution because it's kind of stargazing community. People have understanding of values of dark sky, so they're using lights which are more properly made for night sky and being night sky friendly. That means they're fully shielded, they're more yellow and warm, and I will talk about that later on at the end of the lecture. So this is the beginning of the night in Arches. From Arches, now we are back in Colorado with the Rockies. About this image, there is one thing that I'd like to mention is the nebula you're looking up there is called the North America, next to brightest star Deneb in constellation Cygnus the Swan. But the point is, this is not a regular camera. If I use a regular off-the-shelf camera, most of the red end of the spectrum is cut by a filter known as IR cut. And this filter is responsible to limit the spectrum of visible light in order to keep the sharpness, remove the chance of Moir effect, and there are several good reasons for having IR cut filter, but one of the issues it has is cutting 2/3 of one emission light in the spectrum called H alpha, very important in astronomy. Most of these hydrogen gas in the universe are shining prominently in H alpha, about 650 nanometers. And unfortunately, it's not picking up by the camera unless you remove that filter, replacing it with another IR cut at the end of the red spectrum. That's why I modify some of my cameras. I remove that filter and replace it with another one. I completely remove it to make a full spectrum camera. This is by a company made astrophotography camera. It's Nikon DA10A, stand for astrophotography. Canon also produced one called Canon RA. Both of them are no longer in manufacturing, but you can find them perhaps in the secondhand market. And they have been always one of my cameras, been always modified because to reveal what is not visible to human eyes. We also document the world's observatories. For astronomers, it's important to communicate with people why they have to protect the night sky in the region. And in order to make that communication, they need visuals, imagery that can impact people. That's why every now and then we visit these observatories around the world, those at the front edge of science, for example, Mauna Kea in Hawaii, where you can see some of the largest telescope on the planet, like the two Keck telescope or Subaru. This is at sunset. Or here we are in Haleakala, the neighboring island of Maui, has another observatory. But most people come to the top of Haleakala at 9,000 feet, not to see the stars, but to see the sunrise. This is sunrise in Haleakala. So I spent a couple of nights up there and I realized it's completely absent of people at nighttime. I thought it's going to be, you know, hundreds of people enjoying stargazing there. Well, the main reason is the temperature, because when you go into Maui, you don't expect a polar temperature on top of Haleakala. So people come there with their usual dresses and then they get completely frozen at the beginning of the night. This is Haleakala at nighttime. And there was some interesting activity of meteor showers, but some activity of a thundercloud on the horizon, which captured my attention later on, here and there. So I So it's one camera for a panorama for a thundercloud later on. This is 2 a.m. in Haleakala. And by chance, I had a second camera running a time lapse with a close-up image of the same cloud. And this is the view of that second camera. From Haleakala, now we are in another observatory in Chile. So Chile has this specific condition where it's very dark, absence of light pollution because of Atacama Desert. It's very dry. The Atacama Desert is one of the driest on the planet, and it has high altitude, and it's facing the ocean. So the current that is coming over these observatories are undisturbed. Therefore, it creates something we call perfect astronomical seeing. That's why some of these observatories are located in Chile. And the government is also very cooperating with the organizations in order to host these. A percentage of time of the observatories is given to Chilean astronomers, helping to, you know, increase science in general public of Chile. This is Cerro Paranal. It's also known as astronomer's paradise. It's probably held to any other species, but to astronomers, this is a paradise. More than 300 of the night, it's clear, practically usable for some sort of telescopic observation. You're looking at constellation Southern Cross above VLT, very large telescope. This is an infrared telescope on the left side. Let's have a look at close-up at VLT. Now we are looking at the Milky Way like an arch sitting down. A green laser is used for something called adaptive optics. And this is in order to remove the disturbing that we have on the turbulence we have on star images due to Earth atmosphere. By using this laser, we are trying to remove that turbulence from the image and make much higher resolution in our images. And this adaptive optics is now also widely used in medical science for eye surgeries, for example. And that's how science really works. You start by curiosity and you never know where it ends in other fields. Do you see an elongated diffuse object next to that laser? Any guess? That's Andromeda Galaxy. So you can see this galaxy with naked eye in autumn and winter night. Another galaxy 2.5 million years away from us, million light years away from us, visible to unaided eyes easily in the darkest sky. And also any camera, even with such a wide angle lens, can show it because Andromeda Galaxy is 3 degrees wide. That's 6 times wider than the apparent size of the full moon. And this flare, for those of you who can see it, it's not a meteor. This is a satellite. We'll talk about it later on. Now we are in ALMA, a group of 66 radio telescopes at very high altitude, one of the highest observatories in the world, one of the most complex astronomical observatories on the ground. And usually I do an interesting experience up here for myself when I'm here on assignment for European Southern Observatory. We are obligated to use oxygen assistant capsule because of the altitude. So I remove the oxygen for a few minutes. Look at the sky, it becomes pitch black, and then the stars disappear. And then I put it on, after a few minutes, I have plenty of stars. So what is the best altitude to see stars in the night sky? It's usually 3,000 meters, 9,000 feet. Because if you go higher, although the sky becomes more transparent, you don't have enough oxygen to see them. Now we are in West Texas, McDonald Observatory, one of the darkest places for stargazing and photography in the US. It's still there, but it's struggling with the Permian field of oil and gas because they're active at nighttime. They're very bright areas and it's surrounding the observatory. It's creating massive amount of light pollution and it's not really easily negotiable with this large industry to reduce light activity at nighttime. But still, it's one of the really strikingly dark areas to explore the stars. And there is an annual star party here for those of you interested to join. It's called Texas Star Party. Some astronomers would like to have observatory next to your bedroom. And this is my friend, Maria Mota, a famous physician, cardiologist, who has been really the main push behind the American Medical Association declaration of light pollution problem in 2016. That was a major milestone when AMA announced that white-blue LEDs are harmful to human body. And it's a source of light pollution that we have right now. So he built observatory next to his house. In fact, he built the observatory first and then the house around it, so as according to himself. So we document some of these observatories as well. Some of the images are longer exposure, 1 hour, 2 hour. They're not necessarily a single shot, because with a digital camera on 2 hour exposure, you create a lot of noise. So we break it to a time-lapse sequence of multiple shots, each 20 seconds, 10 seconds. And then we put them together, stack them in order to create one single long exposure. These are examples. Like here in La Palma, Canary Islands, really paradise for stargazers, belongs to Spain, but it's very close to the coast of Africa. And it's a stargazing island, home to several observatories. And the second one is in Grand Canyon under bright moonlight. But look at the third one. That's where I'm going to talk about the problem of objects, man-made objects, such as plane and satellites. And with the increasing number of satellites that this crowd is very well aware of that, we are going to see more and more of these trails across the field, and especially when we are using higher magnification telescopes or telephoto lenses. It doesn't affect a typical stargazer that much, because it's going to be there now and then, and when they reach the optimal altitude, usually they're not visible to human eyes, especially these smaller satellites that we were talking about, like a Starlink. They reach magnitude of probably 6-7 at the optimal altitude of 600 kilometers or so. But during the gain, and also during the time, like in twilight, they can become very bright, flaring, very bright. And there are a number of these projects with several thousands of satellites going to sky, and nobody knows what is the future of this profession, this hobby, or the natural night sky in general, because the astronomy community is very small compared to space industry. And the International Astronomical Union has made some steps forward in order to achieve some result, but you know, this is an ongoing discussion, and I have this concern in some years, you know, every single image will be just filled with this satellite trails. And if the satellites are going to be larger, like this a new project for communication, which the satellite is folding and then spread outside to something much larger than this stage, and when they're going to reflect light, it can be as bright as Venus easily. You remember iridium flares, for example. Iridium satellites were flaring because the antenna was very bright. It was quite attractive for stargazers at the beginning, but then they realized, oh, there's so many of them. They're creating kind of pollution. So we have to be aware of that as well. From now, I'm now shifting to last part of the talk, which is more about light pollution. So this image was captured in 2008 in Tehran, the city I grew up, and it's, you know, with a population of more than 13-15 million, there is no hope for stargazing inside the city. It's like any other major city, like in Chicago, you can't really see more than a handful of stars in the city. I made a sample panorama with the same field of view and orientation inside the city and 70 kilometers away in the Alborz Mountains next to Damavand, in order to make a comparison what is missing in the sky part of this image. This is what is missing. It's striking to see such a difference in only 70 kilometers or 50 miles because of the altitude. This is a much higher altitude area. And this view is gone for most of humanity. But the problem is not only that missing essential beauty of nature, because this is very critical to many species. This is in Rio, and you can see how much the, you know, at first glance, it's really beautiful. It's a legacy of humankind. You know, we have all these cities, but we can use these lights more smartly. We don't need to send them all to space and horizon. We can just control them towards the ground. Very simple. It's not like the problem such as climate change or plastic in the oceans. This is just a cultural shift. We need to use the light more smartly, and we don't need to invest much. It's more about the public awareness, and it's a fight between our fear of darkness. We look at night as an eerie, unsafe environment, naturally, because we are not nocturnal species. I am, but maybe you are not. But if we shift that night has so much to explore, has hidden beauty, and we can live with natural night environment, it's very important for especially wild natural places to keep it naturally dark. In cities, we have lost the battle, for sure. In some smaller cities, there is still hope. For example, two great examples are Flagstaff and Tucson, where there are darkest sky communities. You can see the Milky Way from the edge of Flagstaff, and it's striking in a city or Tucson, you know, just 5 miles out of Tucson on the way to Kitt Peak National Observatory, it's Segura National Park. You start to see the Milky Way in such a large city, because the light has completely changed to sky friendly, fully shielded. They're mainly warm yellow, less scattering. So there is a way, but it's very important for natural places because so many species rely on this darkness. Dubai, this is not cloudy sky, this is clear sky. Niagara Falls. You know, there are two sides of this coin, beauty of light at night and the problem we have. We need to have a solution between. So we did a number of articles on National Geographic website. One was this one in 2019. You can Google it, search NatGeo light pollution. This would be the first result that comes. And the story I proposed was documenting Las Vegas, Los Angeles, and Death Valley as a triangle. Death Valley as a national park, which is a darkest sky park as well, and these two large cities as a source of light pollution. How far away we start to see darker skies. So inside Las Vegas, you are dominated with light, but one is strikingly visible, which is the blue light coming from Luxor or hotel or casino. The idea behind this light is that the spirits of ancient Egyptians are coming out from this pyramid going to the sky. But you're talking about middle of Las Vegas, so it's definitely not about Egyptians. But the amount of light used here, it can run two large size hospitals. I made some calculation once that how much light is coming from this place every night for at least 6 hours since 1990s. For just advertisement. So light is not only used for safety and security, it's used for advertisement, is used for identity sometimes. Light is part of Las Vegas identity, and we have to respect that. But how can we use that more smartly? Light is part of Paris identity. Light is part of Belgium identity as well. Belgium is one of the really heavily lit area in Europe because the highways used to be completely lit, but not anymore, is that right? So that is going to change. So with respect to that, how can we find a solution between? From Las Vegas, now we're in Los Angeles. How far away from Los Angeles you can still see the lights? So I made this experiment. Now I'm standing in Death Valley National Park. That's Los Angeles, 200 miles away, 300 kilometers. If the Earth was not curved, it was probably much more prominent. So even from such a long distance, it was still visible to my eyes on the horizon. And Las Vegas was almost like a sunrise because it's much more concentrated city. and more LEDs. That's the reason. So what kind of light is best to use? The most important is white blue LEDs are harmful not only to human body because they change the circadian rhythm of us. By using white blue lights, you know that the brain is triggered. We have a special sensor, in fact, in our retina only for blue light. And that's the sensor responsible to message the brain that this is daytime, blue sky, daytime, activate the body by dropping the amount of melatonin in the body. So we all know that the story, but what is the Kelvin temperature that reduced that? Because we have to accept this is LED revolution. It's very important for climate change. We have to go on with LEDs, but we also have amber LEDs. We have much softer and warmer LEDs. So amber could be 2700 Kelvin, 2200, even 1800. 1800 Kelvin is almost like wood fire temperature. 2200, it's very relaxing for indoors. 2700, very good for outdoor, like parking lots. Above 3000, you start to see much more white blue in it. Although 3000 is considered white, one of my colleagues did a study, it's at least 20% blue in it. So maybe a bit less than 3000, 2700, that's the limit we're talking about. If you have these white blue LEDs in your home, think about it. And especially in the bedroom, bathroom, in the middle of the night, you're going to the bathroom and then you have a hard time going back to sleep because of the blue rich LED in your bathroom. That could be one reason. And ask about, before that, let me speak about these two. In East Asia, unfortunately, the change to white blue LEDs was too fast. By 2010-11, the start to white blue LEDs really started very fast in East Asia, in China, in Japan, in India as well. And here is a village in Thailand captured by my colleague Pekin Chen. And it was too late when we realized that white blue LEDs are harmful to human body. It was too late. Majority of that part of the world already changed. But in the US, it didn't change that much. And therefore, now in the cities like Chicago, there is a regulation for the temperature of light, which is 3000. In some cities, it's 4000. Like the city I'm based in, Salem, Massachusetts, it's also 3000. And this is an important factor for human health. Light pollution is not only about astronomy, it's affecting ecology, biodiversity, and wildlife. It's affecting human health. It's also affecting energy, climate change, and it's affecting social justice because sometimes we use light for control, social control. And I have documented number of that examples in Brazil, for example, or in Iran, in several places that light was used to control minorities. So it's a large spectrum we're talking about. It's not only astronomy. And think about using motion sensor lights. That's one of the best solutions at the moment. You know, if you're as a single citizen, you like to make a change, and you have this home, vacation home somewhere on a beautiful lake, and you go there a few times per year, don't put on the light every single night there just because it feels safer. You can use a motion sensor, you can use dimmer light, warmer light, and shield it to the ground. So astrotourism is an emerging industry. It's a real thing right now. Astrotourism means people going to places to stargaze because this became such a unique experience, no longer exists. So it became a life-changing experience. Somebody see a natural night sky for the first time. There are generations who have never seen the Milky Way. I remember once took a group of students to a desert stargazing place. On the way, one of the kids looking out, it was in deep twilight, told me, oh, there is cloud coming, unfortunately. I looked out and it was the Milky Way. He has never seen the Milky Way before. And we have generations who have never seen it before. So astrotourism is helping. It's a sustainable small business in many of these places where night sky becomes a way for revenue for locals. So they protect it, they grow the protection, and the place becomes internationally known as a dark sky refuge. Astrotourism could be for aurora watching, could be for meteor showers, new comets, could be even for just simple stargazing. If you go to darksky.org, which is the International Dark Sky Association, you will get plenty of more ideas. I also have a page on my website. If you want to see where you can go to see dark skies, there are maps. I have put it on my page where you can get the most accurate maps of light pollution. The World at Night has a book, which is authored by me, but it's a collection of our team. One third of the images are mine, the rest by my really dedicated team of photographers. It's published in 4 different languages. Chinese one is coming also in a few months. And that's the direct link and the code to my webpage with more information about the book. We also have a website, twanight.org, twanight.org, and this is the same for our social media. Social media handle is the same. So at the end, I'd like to mention how my interest to astronomy started. Lisa kindly mentioned about my first experience of looking through the moon, and I can still remember that second by second. It was a small telescope, a 2-inch reflector. I borrowed it from a neighbor, and I never looked through the moon. I had this book of the moon craters and map, and when I saw it through the telescope, you know, I couldn't believe my eyes. It was like being in Apollo spacecraft orbiter, looking out of the window to the moon's surface. And this can change many people's life. So that's why each time I record moon by my cameras, it's something that resonates me with the beginning of all this, with the adventurous voyage in the past 25 years that I've been to all these places at nighttime, spend time with nocturnal species and connect my future and past under the sky. When you are under naturally dark sky, you feel that connection. It's very unique to Earth and universe at the same time. This was from the coast of Boston when the moon was rising in a very distorted shape. I'm going to leave you with 2 minutes of peace with this music by my colleague Barbat Bayat. We are working on a project called Celestial Orchestra. So we have a number of these for live concert presentations in future. Thank you.
Sit on the right.
I don't think I've ever been quite so speechless in this room, Babak. That was beautiful. And part of my appreciation is you gave a talk that was special for us, including the work that you did to use our big screen, et cetera. But also, I love the way I felt like you were talking to us as scientists, but then pulling us into the sort of deep beauty and urgency of what you're talking about. And I kept finding myself thinking about a question that's near and dear to my heart. It turns out my father was a serious amateur photographer, but what he got really serious about in the last couple decades of his life was trying to ensure that photography was considered art and had the kind of ability to be displayed and elevated in fine art museums and fine art venues, et cetera. And so there was always this question about like photography, art or technology. And it certainly seems like that's the interface you're working in sort of art and science and photography. And I'm curious if you have ideas about, is it art?
Sure. So my background is physics, and then I shifted to science journalism. I was doing photography since that first year with the first look to the moon. You know, the next night I grabbed a camera from a neighbor and tried to capture the first image of the moon. But I was mainly a science journalist when I was in Iran. And so background of science was larger for me. But through the years, I realized art is so important to communicate science with public because it's your way of translation. It's your way of bridging science with public. From photography point of view, to answer your question, the first step, I think there are four parameters for an impactful, powerful image that can make a change or can make the audience to remember it for a long time. It's art, technique, moment and a story. So when these four come together, the image becomes really powerful. And that's why I really try to bring these four in some of my images with a special moment at night, like a new comet or a celestial configuration that is not going to happen again for many decades. And then comes a story. What are you going to share with the audience? And art is very important because if you don't frame it well, if I didn't have any image with panoramic ratio of this screen, this presentation was never available in this format. Yeah. But when I was taking these images, always at each place, I made one panorama. And that's not based on my science background, that's based on art, because this is the way to communicate with public. I'd like to mention also one example by a good friend of mine, Karen Porco. She was the director of Cassini Imaging Spacecraft. We shared a prize, the Lennart Nilsson Award that you mentioned. We won it together in 2009. And the reason she and her group won it, because if you look at the images released by the Cassini team, they're so well framed. Each one is a piece of art. And that's why some of these images of the moon Titan and the ring of Saturn is used in a fine art gallery because it's perfectly framed. And that makes the image much more powerful, not only for communication with people, mm-hmm. but also communication with other scientists. Mm-hmm. You know, if you want to make a presentation which is more impactful, you have to think about the design of my presentation, where I should put this picture in, which picture I should, how many in one single slide. This is art. And any scientist who wants to communicate better, I think, needs the power of art.
Well, I think there's at least several people in the room that are resonating quite strongly with that, and we'll hear more about that tomorrow. You know, we just have a few minutes left, but I was so struck in some of the images, particularly the pictures in and around Tehran and other places in Iran that you showed, and the clear love of your homeland that you have. And are you comfortable saying a little bit about what's going on and your perspective on what is happening in Iran right now?
Yes, I'm comfortable. That's the reason I mentioned at the beginning of the talk as well, because this is not a moment to be silent. Iran has seen many uprisings in the past four decades, and this is not one of them. It's not a single short term, because I think the people of Iran are ready for a change. And that change is already passing the tipping point, because every day the more number of people who are joining together. And a change in Iran can change the Middle East and can mm-hmm. change the world for a better. So that's something that I think the community around the world needs to pay attention to. It's very important milestone in our civilization. And although this is started, it's a woman-led uprising. It started with the hijab issue, but it's not really about that alone. It's not really anti-Islam, not at all, because if you look, some of the most conservative towns in Iran are joining the strikes and protests. These are little towns, people were majority practicing Muslim. Why they're protesting against Islamic Republic? Because this is not anti-Islam uprising. It's about freedom, it's about change, and it's been time for it for a long time, and finally it happened.
Well, I'm going to draw this to a close, but on behalf of our entire community, we express such deep appreciation for the work that you're doing on behalf of the planet, but also for the comments that you just made. And please know that our hearts and our prayers are with you and your people. And I think you will see us sharing the kind of information you just shared, because it's really important for us to not just absorb, but to also share as we do with all of good, robust knowledge.
Thank you.
Thank you, Babak.
Thank you. Thank you.